So yeah, let's get on with TCL. Switch back, and when the screen suddenly changes like that, it'll just be me switching between the virtual terminals. So we've got to do this to increase size, memory size for regular expressions where required. So I'm gonna have to be very careful pasting that I've copied everything, because the cursor block can get in the way and it can be a bit confusing as to what has actually been highlighted. So it just takes a bit of care and attention, what I'm doing here now, to ensure that there's no problems and ensure that I'm actually, don't want to paste that there, ensure I'm actually pasting things correctly. So that's the configure. Next we've got a make. Okay, so now we should be able to install. This mouse is very sensitive, so it takes a bit of care to highlight the correct bits. And finally some headers. Yeah, that missed the S there. Oh no, I did take it, it's just the cursor moved. That's why it can be a bit confusing. Need to check that everything has been typed in correctly. So that should be TCL complete. So the next one is expect. So just like I say, following this on another monitor with a graphical browser, just a lot easier to follow what's going on. So let's extract expect. So now prepare for compilation. So that is the first command. Build the package. And install it. And that looks like that's done. So then move on to Deja GNU. Right, I think I might stick with more, just a bit easier to use, simpler to use. So configure prefix equals tools. And make install. And that's done. A Okay, so that's done with chapter 9, that was, which is the test suite chapter. So now we move into chapter 10, which is installing the basic system software. So I'll quit this, come out of this, and go into... no, it's not that one, is it? Final system, yeah, that's it. Yep, that looks like it. And the first thing we've got to compile is a temporary Perl system. So, temp Perl. So it says in this section, we will add Perl to the temporary system in tools. This package installation should technically be part of 5 construction. Oh, that's just an index to a URL. Should technically be part of constructing a temporary system, but Perl has often had problems with cross-compiling, so we will compile and install it while in the final build environment. So that's what's happening. So let's extract Perl. And first thing we do is put this set in. There, and then we run this configure command. Then build it. Okay, that's complete. It says it's not recommended to run the test, but I probably wouldn't bother anyway. So we'll just install this. And then put this symlink in. And that's Perl completed, yeah. So this is a temporary Perl, so we'll be coming back to do that later. Next thing we've got to do is the Linux headers. So that's the temporary Linux. So what I'm going to do is actually rename that in case I need anything out of it. I doubt it very much. Let's just check the disk space, 3.8. That should be okay. Just thinking about GCC and the 3 gigabytes that needs. Okay, so that's Linux. Linux headers. So we need to copy this command to patch it up to the correct version. That's done. Then clear out the any sources left over, any files from the previous compilation. Run check. Install the headers and then remove some of them that are obviously not needed. And that is complete. So next we've got man pages. So the only thing we do here is a make install, and that's it. So now we move on to the first of the main toolchain packages, which is glibc. So something about libiconv, which we'll ignore, and then it says at the end of the installation, the build test will run a sanity test to ensure everything installed properly. This script performs its test by attempting to compile test programs against certain libraries. However, it does not specify the path to LDSO, and our toolchain is still configured to use the one in tools. The following set of commands will force the script to use a complete path of the new LDSO that was just installed. So let's copy these one at a time and observe any output. As I say, if you're in any doubt, just take your time, do one bit at a time. And generally things are less likely to go wrong. Glibc is self-containable and installed perfectly. The specs and link can't be adjusted before the glibc. So we need to apply a fix for that. Fix the make file. Now we can create a temporary directory to build in and change into it. Then add some configuration parameters and prepare it for compilation. And then build the package. So if the timings are still roughly correct, this will probably take about 5 or 6 minutes. Okay, so yeah, that's just over 5 minutes. That's all good. So now it's time to do the tests. I've actually stacked up the test and the command to view the log in one go here, but I'm going to run them separately. So let's put that in there. And again, this is probably going to be about 20 minutes or so to run these tests. Okay, so that's finished after 26 minutes, which is half the time of the older machine. Still within the sort of range I estimated it to be. So let's now look at the results with this command. And I'll put that through more as well. Okay, it's not much there anyway. So, yeah, these are the results, exactly the same as I got when I did the tests. As it mentions in the notes, NXC.out can be ignored. And the conform test, the last one there, also ignored. And it says some circumstances, some failures are unavoidable, might be missing symbolic link. The other ones we've got, test FTEL partial wide. I looked into that, and that's because the US UTF-8 locale is missing on the system, so that's why that's failed. And the other one, test get ADDR info 4, that failed. That's mentioned here, I think, somewhere. That one there. So they're all accounted for, really, and nothing particularly serious. The US UTF-8 one, which is not in that list, as I say, is accounted for the fact that there's a locale missing. So that's all that is. So it's a successful test, in my opinion. So I think we can move on to install it. So first of all, we do this touch command. And put that in. And then we create a link. And then install. Okay, that's done, and just put that command in. And now I can remove this symlink. We also need to correct the user bin LDD script. And as said, it says check the script to make sure the said work correctly, then delete the backup. So let's look at this file. Let's use fi. And we're looking for ldlinux.so.2. Yeah, there it is. It's inserted this lib64 by the looks of it. RTL DL list, yeah. We can compare it with the backup actually. That is the backup we're looking at. Let's do diff user bin LDD. Yeah, there we go. So you can see that it's removed. What has it done? It's removed this entry here. So all that's left is, it's done a combinator, it's merged these two together actually. It's got /lib, which is that part there, but then it's got ldlinux x86-64, which is this part here, and then this part has remained untouched. So that's what that bit's done there. So that looks all right, it looks like it has done what it's supposed to do. Let's remove the backup. And then we need to copy this config file. Make a directory. And then we need to create the locale. So you can run this command to create them all, or alternatively, just create this directory and then create the individual ones. And these ones that are specified here are for all the tests that are due to come that require locales. So I'm just going to put them in. Whether or not I need every single one of them, don't know, but I'll put them in. And I'm going to modify the US one. It's probably about the closest to insert my own locale. So then we've got some configuration. Just check that looks okay. And then we've got the time zone to put in. Time zone information, that's okay. Now to determine the local time zone, run this command. Select the area of the world I'm in from the country. That looks all good. So Europe, London is the zone I'm in. So I'll copy this. Paste this in. And then finish the command off with that line there. And that's done. And then the last thing I've got to do is to create ldso.conf. Oops. And I'll just verify that's been written correctly. And yep, that looks okay. So that is the end of glibc. Just get back to where I was. Yeah, that's the end of that one. So I'll go back and tidy up. And move on to adjusting the tool chain next. So let's just check this is the right page. Yes, it is. So I've got to put this command in to adjust the specs. And then we verify that everything's working correctly. And it should read lib ld linux x86664. Lib ld linux x86664 SO2, so that's fine. And remove the dummy C and A out. And that's that. So now we move on to M4. So configure prefix equals user. Okay, and we'll build it. Test the results. Well, let's do a quick check. Make sure everything's working up to this point. Yeah, that's all okay. I didn't expect anything else actually. And install, and that's it. One thing I will do is set term. Have we got that? Yes. As I noticed during the GDBC, the terminal blanked. So I'll set that to zero to stop it from blanking again for. Probably GCC when that comes up. So that's M4. Next we've got GMP. It says if you're compiling this package on a different CPU than you plan to run the CLFS system, we must replace GMP's config.guess and config.subwrappers. So I'm not going to be doing that. I'll just go straight ahead and configure it. Be interesting to see what it optimizes the code for, what processor this time. As you remember, it went for a K8 before, but like I said, I think it's probably just a generic 64-bit, the lowest common denominator. So yes, it's gone for a 64-bit this time, so that's good. So let's run make and see if we can catch what it's doing as it goes past. Right, yeah, it has gone for core 2, so that's what I would have expected it to be, so that's fine. That's done. Let's build some documentation. Uh, and I'll run some tests because GMP is quite a critical part that's used by GCC. Again, don't expect there to be any problems with this. Look, all 20 test pass, that was that part. Yeah, there's some more there. Unfortunately, a lot of it went past the screen, but it's finished without reporting any errors. That's the main thing. It's not aborted or anything. So let's install. And just one more command. Install HTML and that's GMP done. So next we move on to MPFR. So apply a patch, prepare for compilation. And build it. Check the results. Again, it's a critical component of the tool chain. It's used by GCC, so it's worth checking. That's done, all passed, so let's install. And that's complete. Now we move on to MPC. Have compilation. build it. Build some documentation. Test the results. So that looks like that's all okay, and we'll install it now and install the documentation. That's done. So next we've got ISL. Compilation. Compile it. And test it. Again, this is a library for GCC, so critical to get this correct. All four tests passed. Now install it and move a misplaced file. And that's done. The Klug next. So prepare for compilation with this command. Okay, config okay, it says apply a sed. And compile it. And again, it's another library that's used by GCC, so we'll test this. equal 5 passed, good. And install it. And that's clue done. Next we've got zlib. So we configure the build with that command, build it, check the results, and install it. Just some moving around of some files. Install some documentation. And that's it, I think. Yep. So next we've got flex. So I prepare for configuration with this command. And build it. And make check. Now when I ran this, I got three errors. And it does state in the instructions that three tests will fail due to missing Bison. However, when I built Bison, came back and retested, one did pass, but the other two caused seg faults. So I'm not really sure what happened there. I guess I could try it again. There's those three failures there. So I'll install this for now. And just put this compatibility script in and change the mode of it. So that means we should be able to use Lex, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's it for that one. So I'll tidy that up. And move on to the next one, which is Bison, in fact. So, just I think this is a straightforward build, as I remember. Configure it. Build it. Okay, I'll just run make again in case there's any problems with the parallel build. No. Test results. Yeah, that passed there. Let's stop that a moment. Three passes there, yeah. And then it's doing individual tests, so I'll wait for them to finish. Okay, so all the tests that were run were successful, 23 was skipped, so that's all good. So we just install it. I'll do an ld config before we run flex again. Let's just check there's nothing else to do there. No, so let's get the flex one up again. And let's have a go at testing flex, rebuilding it and then testing it. So configure it. Compile it. Test the results. Yeah, there's the two seg faults there, so it's happened exactly as before. So I don't know why this behaves like this, but the fact that the behavior is identical, I'm happy to carry on despite that. So you can see that there's only two failures now instead of three. So Bison has made a difference, but why there's a problem with those two errors and that they seg fault now, I don't know. So that's flex. Let's move on to bin utils next. So we run this expect command, we should get spawn ls printed on the screen, which is good. Anything else needs to be investigated. We'll build a temporary build directory, configure the build, and compile it with this command. Now, this should only take a couple of minutes, I think. Okay, yeah, a minute and a half. That probably is about a third of the time of the previous build. So let's just check this. Yeah, so it's the link we've got to do next here. Test the results. Again, this should take roughly the same amount of time. And we're watching the results because I think they go off the screen quite quickly. Tests. Right, there's one unsupported test there. Put the rest past. That one all passed as well. And there's all good there as well, no unexpected failures, so that's all fine. Remove the temporary symlink. That's all good, and install the package. That's good. So now we move on to GCC. And we must ensure there's 3 gig here available. Yes, there is 3.6 gig, so that's plenty. Okay, so let's extract. And start with the build. So first up, we've got a few patches to put in. And another one here. A set substitution. And then we build in a separate directory. Configure the build. And then we actually perform the build. So this is probably going to take 20-ish minutes. Okay, that's finished compiling, so it's time to run the tests. And we've got to increase the stack size first, and then run make check. So this could take maybe 3/4 an hour or so. Right, so that's finished testing, taken about 1 hour and 11 minutes. And we've got some errors to check, so we can use this command and we can pipe it through this command and also through more so it doesn't go off the screen. So let's just see what I've got. When I ran this myself earlier, expected pass, expected failures, unsupported tests. So that's actually a better result than I got when I ran the test myself. I had one unexpected failure on G++. So I'm not sure why that is. It could be something to do with the kernel. I did configure the kernel differently. So that's a good thing. Expected passes, expected failures, unsupported tests. That's fine. That's fine. Right, we had one fail on libgomp. Or five, it says here, actually. On libgomp, which is what I had previously, so that's okay. Libitm's fine. Libmudflap, unexpected failure 3. Again, I had that. So that's okay. Libstandard C++, that's okay. So in actual fact, it was slightly more successful this time than in my own testing. So, as I said, that's probably more to do with the kernel being slightly different. So I'll install the package now. And copy an include header. Create a shortcut. And another symlink. One misplaced file, and that looks like that's it. So let me just check that I haven't missed anything. Yep, that looks good. So that's GCC done. So what I'm going to do now is to finish up, and really because this is a system that is live, it will be the final system we use. There's nothing to take down or to bring up at the reboot. So if I just tidy this up, basically I can just do, if I log out of this and do shut down, in fact I'll do a reboot. We don't need to do anything else. And after it's rebooted, it comes back up again. I can carry on from exactly where I left off without having to do anything else. So it's quite convenient from that point of view. So yeah, I'll just carry on as if I hadn't taken a break. So I'll log in and I'll go to the sources book. I'll get the book up first. And this is the final system. And we haven't done less yet, have we? No. This is sed. So that's the instructions for sed. In this terminal, I'll log in, go to sources. There's all our packages. Just double check I haven't got any directories hanging around that I've forgotten to clear up apart from the Linux one, which is the old copy. And extract sed and start building this one. So first, right, my mouse has gone to sleep again. No, right, first of all, yes, I've got to do GPM. I forgot about that. So that's not the mouse that's gone to sleep, it's me. So GPM, put this commands back in to get the GPM working. What I'm going to do actually is to highlight that and edit a, where's the squiggle on this keyboard? There it is. Create a shell file to just run, because eventually when the network comes, the network tools get installed, I'll need to activate that as well, so it's just easier putting it into a script. So I'll call this boot up. Where's the hash? Yeah, the keyboard's set up for US keyboard, so it's a bit of a hit and miss on the UK keyboard. So that's the command for activating the mouse. So I'll just test that. Yeah, seems to have worked. Okay, so let's go back to the instructions and configure sed. And build it. Build some documentation. And install it. And install the documentation as well. So that's sed complete. Okay, and we can move on to package config lite. And let's get configure. Build and install it, and that's that one done. And the next package is ncurses. So we've got a patch to begin with. Followed by a configuration. Oops. Okay, and we can build that. And install it. So we've got some libraries to move around. And some symlinks. It says many packages use NCursor compilers found against the wildchild libraries, but won't know to look for them. Create linker scripts and symbolic links to allow older and non-wide compatible programs to build properly. So we'll just copy all this in. And that should be done. Yep, that's complete. So the next package we've got is Shadow. So let's get that one up. Oh. Didn't want to do that, did I? It was NCursor. I knew that would happen. I nearly did it when I was testing. So NCursor is the one I want to delete. Right, luckily I've got a copy in pre-CLFS. No, I haven't. Where did I have it? Oh, I thought I had it in there. Oh yeah, packages, yeah, I'm going blind. So, pre-CFS. Right, CP Shadow, no, CP CLFS, Shadow to sources. Right, let's try again. So Shadow, so if you want to enforce the use of strong passwords, refer to CBLFS. For building Shadow, is that right? Yeah, for installing Crackly prior to, right. Okay, so we don't do that. We just start down here with these two commands. So let's put this one in first. That's okay. This one next. prepare for compilation. Build. That's done, so now we can install it. Instead of using the default DES method, use the more secure SHA-512 method of password encryption, which also allows passwords longer than 8 characters. It's also necessary to change the obsolete VASPL mail location for the user mailbox that Shadow uses by default. Use the following set to make these changes. Okay, so let's do that. Move a misplaced program to its proper location. Configuration. So we just run pwconv to use shadow passwords and groupconv to use shadow groups passwords. To view or change the default settings, use account, edit etc default user add. Right, so setting the root password. So what you set here is what you'll need to use to log on to the root. So currently we've been logging on and there's been no prompt for the password root because it doesn't exist, but now we'll create one and the next time we log on it will ask for a password. So if I go to another virtual terminal, type in root, you can see it's now asking for the password and I'm in on that terminal. Contents, and that looks like that's it. So let's now go to the next package, which is util linux. Okay, FHS compliant notes. Compliance notes. So it says that the FHS recommends using the varlib hardware clock directory instead of the usual etc directory as the location for the ADJ time file. To make the hardware clock program FHS compliant, run the following. So there's two commands here, by the looks of it. So it's that one. And that one. So that's done. Installation, find mount and list block. Can utilize libudev for WWN serial number information. This is desired. Rebuild util Linux after EUDEV 1.7. So I'm not particularly worried about that. We'll just crack on with the configuration. And the build. Test results, and we'll just go straight to install. And move one binary. And I think that's it. Yep, so move on now to proc psng. Okay, so this will give us things like proc, I imagine, which we haven't got at the moment. Let's build it. When using the boot method, two tests will fail if the host name is not set. Okay, so this did actually work for me when I ran the test, but like I said, I'm not running them now. Install and move central files to a location that can be found if user is not mounted. And that's done. So it looks like there we've now got the free program, which, yep, is reporting the memory and PS is it we've got, yep. So there's a few useful utilities there. Okay. E2FS progs next. So we need a temporary directory to build in. Configure the build. And perform the build. That's done, and we'll run the install. And install libs. And it looks like that's done. Core utils next. Right, so first of all, we've got a patch. And we configure it with this command. Build it. Not run the tests, so let's jump straight down to here and install and move some programs to some recommended locations. And that's Core Utils done. So now we're going to go to IANA etc. So we've got a patch to put in. Let's do that first. That should have been in that window. And build it. And install it. Done. It's got libtool. Right, so we configure and build. And install. And that's libtool done. Okay, the next is IP route. So after this has been installed, we'll be in a position where we should be able to activate the network and then carry on back on the remote machine with the graphical environment. So it should be a lot easier to complete the build from that position. So time on a 6-bit IP route. What was that note about? Okay, it's just about what this does, about removing a binary, but if you need it, not to run it. So, looks like we just build this straight away without any configuration. And install it with some documentation by the looks of it. And that's done.